By confronting major public health issues of our time and creating an environment where we can really openly discuss and even debate ideas, I think that this school can become a catalyst for change and help to transform public health. And that's why we selected the Chinese character for transformation as the icon for the program. And I want to thank Brian Weiner and Megan Lewis for providing the inspiration for the symbol. I confess that I wasn't thinking about the statistical aspects of transformation, but it does have an additional benefit. This lecture series is really meant to pay tribute to significant leaders in public health whose accomplishments and thinking put them at the very top of their leagues. And we want to recognize their contributions, learn from them, and help Carolina's School of Public Health transform itself to keep pace with the imperatives of the 21st century. As good as our school is, and I really believe that it's outstanding, if we don't keep our focus ahead, we're not going to be prepared for changes in world health. As I interviewed for the job of dean and afterwards, I really was thinking about creating a very different and special kind of lecture series, but it really fell into place after a conversation I had with Dennis Gillings, and I went back and kind of wrote it all up and decided exactly what we should do. And so what do we want to happen today as a result? So as we leave here later, I hope that you'll think about the ideas that Dennis presents and that it can be a subject of conversations among and between us. And that you will continue to challenge the school about issues of leadership and what we should be doing and going. When we decided to initiate this series, two names came to mind. One was Dennis Gillings and the other is Bob Gresham, and you'll be hearing from Bob, the CEO of Blue Cross Blue Shield of North Carolina, in January. Today, we're really honored to welcome you, Dennis. Dennis is the chairman and CEO of Quintiles Transnational Corporation. Dr. Gillings is familiar to many people at the school because of his career here as a professor of biostatistics. From what I understand from talking to students and faculty, while he was here, he was an inventive teacher and researcher and as charismatic a figure then as he is today. He and Gary Cook ran the biostatistics consulting lab in a trailer that sat on the where this wonderful new building is today. I think the trailer is as much a part of UNC lore and as a cultural icon as Steve Jobs' garage. So much so that I was telling Dennis after I became dean and I heard we were going to be doing a renovation, I went to Robert Shelton and asked for a trailer, but he didn't give it to us, as you can see. Now, less than a quarter century later, Quintiles Transnational is the global leader in pharmaceutical services with offices in 50 countries and more than 16,000 employees. As the chairman and CEO of Quintiles Transnational, Dennis Gillings' contributions to pharmaceutical services, clinical trials, and business are recognized around the world, so much so that last year in London, Queen Elizabeth II made him a commander of the British Empire. And I suspect that very few of us will be able to add that designation to our CVs. Perhaps of even more importance to the school, Quintiles has hired many, many of our graduates, and Quintiles and a number of the faculty in this school who are associated with Quintiles have been very generous to this school. After Dennis talks, we'll take a few minutes for questions and comments, and then we'll proceed upstairs and hopefully continue the discussion and the dialogue. And I hope this will be the beginning of many conversations. Dennis, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much. That was a delightful introduction. I'm really delighted to be here. I thought actually it was going to be a little nostalgic because the trailer was just sort of over there. And I spent 15 years there, so that was quite a long while in one's life. But this is such a wonderful building, looks so totally different that one can't really refer to it as nostalgia. But it is a delight to be here, and this is a wonderful lecture hall. So thank you for the invitation. Now, today also, this is World AIDS Day, and so I think this is actually a good choice for my presentation, which, as Barbara said, grew out of a conversation we had some months ago. So let's roll in and try to identify, I think, two sets of experiences of my life. One, 15 years here, and one about 20 years in business, so relatively equal. And you might think from very opposite ends of the spectrum. So what I'm going to say, I think, is a consolidation of seeing either end of the spectrum. I want to talk about a value proposition, and I'll deal with it in five parts. I thought I'd try to be constructive, and so build what is the mission of a school of public health, look at the 20th century, what it may have achieved, look in the future what may need to be done, particularly pay attention to the value proposition as it relates to the healthcare dollar, and then make a few comments about how schools of public health can increase their value. So let's first go with the value proposition. What exactly do we mean here? And I think in business, value is driven by a thing called ROI, return on investment. And that is probably very familiar to you all in investments. And it really is a very competitive world out there. And to show the competitiveness, I searched the web and looked up schools of public health in order to gain an impression of how different schools were presenting themselves. And I did, by the way, find that Johns Hopkins and Harvard were very competitive for the School of Public Health here. So I thought to beat Hopkins and Harvard, the school at Chapel Hill has to really go some. Now, in that sense, I do believe demonstrating value is going to be more and more important. And so on this chart, we want to move to that top left-hand box by giving a lot of benefit for the money spent. Now, I think value also may be one of the biggest issues in healthcare in the United States because it does seem to many that costs are out of control. Now, therefore, what is my value proposition? My value proposition is that academic strengths combined with business strengths will put public health in a better position for 21st century advances. And perhaps also the added value can be marketed to the public at large and build a broader base for support. So let's build this value proposition then, as I'm referring to it, something additive to public health, by first disentangling public health. So let's go back to a little basics. And what is the mission of the School of Public Health? And again, going to websites, in fact, I hate to admit this, I chose what Harvard had it on its website in order to try to focus very succinctly what the mission of a School of Public Health was. It clearly addresses populations rather than individuals, focuses on disease prevention and health promotion, and uses interventions, be they environmental, be they behavioral, or be they medical. Now, as one talks then in this sense about the applied research agenda of a School of Public Health, One can, its applied research agenda, compare with a business. And I made this little chart, which really helped me conclude maybe a school of public health isn't that much different, in its, at least in its applied research characteristics, than a school of public health isn't that much different from the business I run every day at Quintiles. The value we bring is profit. A school of public health, by this definition, brings disease prevention and health promotion. We deliver services and products to the pharmaceutical industry. The school of public health identifies and perhaps delivers interventions. We deal with market segments. In our case, it's the pharmaceutical industry. You deal with defined populations to which you bring these interventions. So, quite an analogy. That actually made me feel better as I was on this path of mixing and matching business. But I did want to take it a little further. This isn't all one does in a school of public health. So, again, I went back to the same website and tried to couch a public health the way the business might couch its offerings. So the products are teaching and research and service. The organization here is based on analytical methods. It's also based on the setting and the population, such as occupational health or international health. And it's also based, perhaps, on the substantive health problem, environmental health or nutrition or the like. So you have an organizational structure in that way, the same way as a business would get organized. And there's some fundamental disciplines surrounding the biological sciences, the numerical sciences, and the social sciences, where the primary expertise of the faculty and students come from. Okay, so we have a workable mission statement, and I think well-defined what a school of public health is, at least by me abstracting things that are published by schools of public health on their websites. So now, let's move on. Let's think now of the 20th century. In order to think about value, let's think about what public health may have done or what it can claim to have done in the 20th century in order to gear our thinking to how some of these values that we want to portray to add value may go. Now, perhaps the hallmark achievement of the 20th century is life expectancy, at least in health matters, went up dramatically. Maybe this cartoon succinctly describes it. Many parents today who are much older look much younger than they did perhaps in our own parents' generation's time. So 70 being the new 50 may well be a headline for the achievements of a number of health matters in the 20th century, but public health would take a lot of credit. During the 20th century, life expectancy increased by approximately 30 years. And that was primarily in the developed world, but that is an absolutely overwhelming achievement. But I want to divide this into two parts. I want to take the first half of the 20th century and the second half. In the first half of the 20th century, it went in the United States from 49 to 68, mainly due to old-fashioned public health, sanitation, nutrition, and vaccines. Quite a remarkable change in the characteristics of the population, and that remarkable change was two-thirds, pretty much, of the whole advance of public health throughout the 20th century. So very, very dramatic. I think, though, there's another point on this slide that it is very important to point out. Smallpox, which in no large measure would take a lot of credit for these advances in life expectancy was actually, if you ferret away, and the chief medical officer at Quintiles corrected me on the date, back in 1768 was originally published, but the adoption time before it had any material public health impact was amazing, well over 100 years, because the impact didn't really come until the 20th century. And you'll see, following on the heels of smallpox, a number of vaccinations that you're very familiar with. These would probably take a large amount of the credit, together with sanitation, for those enormous advances. Now, vaccines also advanced in the second half of the 20th century, although did not impact, as it was probably impossible to do, life expectancy to anywhere near that same amount. But vaccines, with flu vaccines, AIDS vaccines, continue today as a very major public health advance. And we see here, if we look at the whole century, the declining rates from infectious diseases. And I think one does need to look at that carefully, because you do see the influenza pandemic just after the First World War, at the end of the First World War and beyond, which took death rates at that time back about 40 or 50 years, back before the beginning of the century, which is very sobering. And of course, much in the news at the present time, but of course, preventing that points to an enormous value add to society that can be achieved. Now, the second half of the 20th century, I think, is a little different. Life expectancy here goes from about 68 to 77, so about a third of this 30-year gain. So not anywhere near as large, but nevertheless dramatic. I would characterize it, though, not so much by public health. I would characterize it by medicine and by pharmaceuticals. And many of the gains that may be illustrated by pharmaceuticals came from the general areas of pharmaceuticals that you see on the slide. And I think there's another interesting thing that now begins to happen. Instead of life expectancy, which is not coming or improving as much, there's now another overlay on it, which I think one can characterize as quality of life. So in the second half of the 20th century, you begin to get life expectancy continuing to improve, but because of an emphasis and a recognition of chronic diseases, probably by competing risks, one moves to an assessment of quality of life. Now, the pharmaceutical interventions, I think, have often been overlooked at the enormous contribution to American society and, in fact, developed society over the years. And these data come from pharma itself, but also from the Boston Consulting Group and the National Center for Health Statistics. And I would note that from the Centers for Disease Control, in 1998, chronic diseases accounted for 75% of U.S. deaths, which would be a dramatic change from an earlier time when, of course, infectious diseases were causing a large number of deaths. The corresponding costs for chronic diseases at the same time, as quoted by the CDC, is 70%, that's 70, of U.S. medical costs. And I would quote the World Health Organization Director General Hiroshi Nakajima, who emphasized this point about quality of life. He was the Director General of the World Health Organization from 1988 to 98. He said, "Health expectancy is more important than life expectancy." And I think he said that in 1997, or at least it was a publication in 97. So we get this shift, which I think is very interesting. I would also, of course, like to point out the incredible change in infant mortality during that period of time, a 16-fold decrease through the century. Enormous value added, gigantic. Okay, so now we've covered some maybe core ideas of what has driven value in the 20th century. And perhaps at the very least, we can give public health credit for 2/3 of it, which is enormous. But that 2/3 would primarily have come in the first half. And perhaps medicine and pharmaceuticals would take the top spot in the second half. Let's now move on to the 21st century to see where we might be going. And of course, this is very germane to a school of public health. Can it get the top spot again? As I deep in my bones feel, it probably deserves if it can only get its act together. So let's have a look. Maybe this is a bit of a conundrum or a dilemma that may express a number of things. No, I don't want to live forever, ever, but I damn sure don't want to be dead forever, too. And that, you know, hints of how many people or many things come across in the United States and in the rest of the developed world. I think biology suggests that a feasible lifespan may be in the 100 to 120 year range. And if that is the case, or at least it would appear the case as we look at known biology today, it seems that we have a two-way bimodal attack that public health can have. And this two-way bimodal attack is, first of all, there are two very different types of populations, the developed world and the developing world. And there's two very clearly differentiable type of disease structures, chronic and the communicable diseases. And then, by and large, in the developed world, the emphasis would be more on chronic diseases, but remember this blip that happened after the First World War is a threat. And likewise, or correspondingly, in the developing world, more communicable diseases or infectious diseases of one sort or another. But with the wealthier people in those countries having all the chronic disease issues. So there's a little bit of crossover. Now, I think it's also reasonable to say that public health will have to deliver solutions and not just study them in order to add value. And given the incredibleness of costs, health economics will be a major means of delivering healthcare solutions and hopefully will not be a barrier to healthcare solutions. So now let's think of another characteristic also, which is studied very widely here in the School of Public Health, and that is the whole notion of data, because data has taken on, I think, a role with the World Wide Web that's so much greater because of its accessibility and availability. And I think a key thing that one does in business is one does tend to measure everything one does and track the improvement of everything one does in order to compete in a very competitive, profitable marketplace. Now, likewise, in public health, we track events and rates closely. If we do this, we may improve things. And data, I think, is also expanding to include genetic information, on an ever-increasing scale. So epidemiology will be characterized, and is probably already being characterized, to a much greater extent, and indeed also biostatistics, by genetic information carrying along with normal morbidity, mortality, and demographic information. And data-based approaches may include registries, and in particular, evidence-based medicine is gaining visibility, and as health economic factors are considered, evidence-based medicine may continue to gain even more visibility. So public health expertise may need to expand from current core disciplines, or certainly from core disciplines as I remember them. They may and possibly should include health economics. I say here informatics. I take informatics beyond biostatistics and epidemiology by using all available information, and then also genomics, which I've just mentioned. And it's very likely that these disciplines should be added to what I've characterized as the more traditional disciplines in the sort of thing that's taught if we are to tackle the 21st century. Now let me put up a straw man, because these ideas do, I think, enable a 21st century straw man to be postulated. And what I've done here, I've taken the first half of the 20th century, traditional public health, also characterized the gain in life expectancy, and then the yellow is the developed world, and the white in the last column is the gain in the developing world. The second half of the 20th century, we're characterizing by medicine and pharmaceuticals. In the first half of the 21st century, we may take a stab of characterizing advances, certainly in the developed world, coming if we properly teach, apply, and build into solutions, economics, genomics, and biostatistics and epidemiology plus informatics. Now, the gain in life expectancy there, I didn't conjure out of the blue. I took those from United Nations projections based on population projections that have been done by the United Nations. I wouldn't hang my hat on them, but they actually look pretty plausible. Developed world's expectancy of life gains, maybe 6 more years, and developing world's expectancy of life gains, maybe as much as 18 more years. So that's on a curve still going up, whereas with the quality of life moving in, and I think there will be a third factor if we take in the developed world life expectancy, quality of life. I think the third factor that will be assessed on is maximizing life. It's not just quality, it's how much more one gets out of life. If that is the case, there'll be this third characteristic added to the value added measurements for the first half of the 20th century. Okay, a straw man. Sometimes a straw man is very useful, if only to guide one, but also to knock down and build a better one. Okay, so I've implied a huge mitigating factor, though, is cost as we move into the 21st century, or more broadly, health economics. And so it's going to be enormously important to look very carefully at the value of the healthcare dollar. Now, there's a new disease that keeps on growing in the United States. I've lived in the United States over 30 years, and this number that I think the number that are not insured, a number I use anyway, is 46 million. But you read a lot of numbers in the 40 millions. This number continues to increase. So it does seem to be a pretty chronic disease that's taking place. And so that, obviously, I suppose, among all others, illustrates what health economics may do to what is otherwise a very reasonable goal to expect most people in a very developed country to be fully taken care of. Let's have a look at that a little more, a chart I'm sure you've seen endlessly and probably appears endlessly in many lectures here. The United States does outspend many other countries, indeed outspends all other countries in terms of healthcare. And the figure that I have for 2003 is $1.7 trillion, over 15% of gross domestic product, or $5,700 almost per capita. And some say that's projected to grow to 19% by 2015. So that, I would say, is quite staggering. Now, as one looks at, again, a number of other charts that I'm sure you study and have studied in a number of lectures, on a macro evaluation basis, it doesn't give as much value added as one would like. Here you see life expectancy is somewhat lower in the US, but there's a couple of statistics that actually struck me as a little surprising. The US lags in 5-year survival for colorectal cancer and also 5-year survival from kidney transplants. And of course, in a highly technological society, that I think is a little surprising. Also in a highly technological society, a study reports 98,000 deaths in the United States due to medical errors. I've no real idea whether the 98,000 is a valid number, but clearly the number is big, which is probably the point there. So we can look at this in a variety of ways, but we do tend to think, as we look at it, that there is not value because there's a lack of access issues. The headline, 46 million people uninsured. There's quality issues. Here a headline is 55% of recommended care is actually received by patients. And then there's efficiency issues, such as the growth in administrative costs outweigh the growth in expenditures. So those sorts of macro indicators really point to a value proposition that needs a lot of serious assessment. But as we take this a stage further and look at value and ethics, we start to get great conundrums. And I think it's perhaps frightening that 30% of the Medicare budget is spent in the last year of life. Maybe that's not so bad, but of this, nearly 40% is spent in the last 30 days. That does strike me as a lot of room for public health dissertations that actually offer solutions. Although in a society as complicated as the United States, solutions will not be easy. But of course, great academic institutions take on great intellectual challenges. And I think this is one that as one gets to the last 30 days of life, one would have to characterize it by saying that is not where we truly see the value of healthcare expenditures. Now, moving from developed countries like the United States, Johns Hopkins put a high regard on 10 cheap ways to save the world. And actually, this is quite a good slide. I'd pick on one, vitamin A. Vitamin A supplements reduce malaria, dysentery, and measles, and have the potential of saving hundreds of thousands of children's lives. And you see here, all these 10 mainly relate to the developing world, although a few will also carry over into the developed world. So I think things like this do point there are high impact solutions that also have extraordinarily good value, although we don't always get these solutions into our system as well as we might like to. But now let me take a totally different tack. And let me make a proposition that maybe the Gates Foundation and Bill Gates, a software billionaire, has actually had the biggest impact on public health, outweighing many governments combined and perhaps outweighing all the schools of public health in the United States combined, which becomes a sort of an interesting point. Someone from a totally different field becomes a multi-billionaire, creates a huge foundation that probably was very much dismissed by public health professionals, focuses on high value things such as vaccinations, and is beginning to have huge and measurable impact. And of course, there's another quaint way of looking at this. This is someone totally from outside that puts money on the table. And perhaps in a way that was very focused. Bill Gates gave an address to the World Health Organization in the early part of this year. This was in Geneva, and offered four priorities for health inequities in the developing world. The first, increase government commitment. The second, focus on high value research. The third, build delivery into design. And the fourth, make political and market forces work. And of course, numbers two and three, the high value research and the building delivery and design, particularly, I think, applies to schools of public health. Now, I think the Gates priorities point the need to public-private partnerships. And I think schools of public health can play an incredible role in facilitating public-private partnerships. Now let us try to take these ideas and move on to some conclusions about now how schools of public health may increase value. I think we have to be a little careful. We must be careful to make solutions that are understandable, and so communication and simplifying rather than complexifying, I think, does become a very important ingredient to what comes out of an academic institution. I chose a PhD dissertation to focus on. It's a major product of a school. And I doodled with a little calculation. You may or may not agree with it. It was set up as a straw man anyway. Maybe a dissertation takes 3,000 to 5,000 hours. If one was a professional in a corporation with overhead attached, those hours, and there's a lot of overhead in these beautiful rooms, of $100 or $200 an hour wouldn't be an unreasonable cost, that makes a dissertation worth $300,000 to $1 million, just by multiplying the two smallest numbers and the two biggest numbers together. Pretty valuable dissertation, I guess. The graduates would like to sell them for that. I really made the point for a somewhat different point. Let's choose the low number, and be my guest to choose another number. Are dissertations worth that much? I think we may say maybe they're not. I think it is a major product of a school like this. And so the value of a dissertation may be one thing that one could really concentrate and focus on. Are we pushing out dissertations that really add value? Or are we pushing out dissertations that, after all, don't add that much value? I chose to make a suggestion of how one chose dissertations, not to say dissertations should just be in these areas, but I think in order to get a view of importance or a view of value, I just went to the top five risk factors that the World Health Organization identify in developed countries and then also in developing countries. And in developing countries, they're split into two parts, the high mortality countries and the low mortality countries. And of course, on World AIDS Day, I think we should take particular note of the unsafe sex one on the right-hand side there. And that problem will not get better very easily. But that sort of approach will help distinguish value from lesser value. So some very simple ideas and some very easily available information, I think, gets us on this road to determining how we may differentiate the value of some dissertations versus others. I make the premise that if a school turns out a lot of valuable dissertations, it will have a lot more impact on society. So now let me try to put all my remarks together. And I'm going to come up with five bottom line comments or ways for a school of public health, from my perspective, may be able to increase value. The first, which is, I think, implied by my previous remarks, demonstrate value for research that's undertaken here. Think about, would anyone actually pay what it really costs to do this? And is it adding value to society? And this is both for dissertations and for research papers. Secondly, generate a broad base of social, political, and community support. Think about the marketing of the public health message more professionally, and partnering particularly with business. And I think the whole notion of public-private partnerships also come in here. Number three, and this is a very interesting one, implement accountability and transparency for measures of results. And what I mean here is for departments as they exist in the school. First of all, it's very important to measure what you do, and I think this must go beyond listing of publications. You should really try to identify the value that's being added. And then having departments accountable for adding this value and making the results transparent and posted for all to see. In fact, it was interesting. On Tuesdays, I was shown this just before, earlier today, in the to show you the full impact of this. In the New York Times on Tuesday of this week, in the science section on page D2, there was a headline about the United Nations, AIDS goal missed. And I'll quote what it said in the New York Times. The World Health Organization's failure to meet a goal of treating 3 million HIV-infected people by the end of this year owes to inadequate international coordination and lack of national leadership. And then the article goes on to say, crucial to that strategy is a much more systematic approach to setting goals, measuring progress, and assessing and addressing barriers to providing AIDS treatment. I think that illustrates to a T perhaps the point being made here. The fourth, which I hope I illustrated by the earlier part of my comments, focus the mission and the message. I tried to bring some focus to what public health has accomplished, certainly by my way of looking at it and looking at the web and reading and so forth. But I think a focus like this should be imposed broadly with particular emphasis on feasibility in order to add value. So, in other words, choose those parts of the mission, choose those messages where progress is more feasible rather than some that are less feasible. And then my fifth point is think more about delivery. And this is a very deep-rooted comment by myself. In business, delivery would be operations or implementation. And I would be the very first to say that ideas are hard to implement. And I've learned this in business the hard way, that it is often easier, at least I find it much easier, to come up with an idea than to actually implement an idea. I did find when I was an academic that the people that did the ideas were felt to be a little lower class citizens. And so I would make that comment, and maybe that's the most important takeaway message. Ideas are very hard to implement. I thank you for being able to make my comments. I had thought long and hard about these things, maybe over the course of 30 years, and hopefully I was able to put together and gel at least some of my reactions to the sum total of my two experiences here in the school and in the business world. I'd be delighted to entertain questions. Jim.
There's one of your slides that gave great prominence to the development of pharmaceuticals for extending life expectancy. And I don't want to quarrel with that at all. But I did think it's worth pointing out that schools of public health had a big role to play in the development of these pharmaceuticals. Yep. And for example, just today, there was a large description of the results of the Framingham study in the form of an obituary who's, I had a senior moment, I can't remember the guy's name who did it, but it was very important. And it showed the toll taken by high cholesterol, hypertension, and things like that. Now, schools of public health, including this one, led in developing the first studies that showed that a pharmaceutical intervention could protect against high cholesterol. Now, it was a very poor drug, but without the knowledge that a drug could do it and without the knowledge of the potential market size out there, we probably wouldn't have statins. And it also was, we could make a similar statement about the effects of hypertension. Without the role of the School of Public Health in demonstrating that even modest hypertension has its own toll and that this is an enormous market out there. And doing prevention studies to show that you could actually impact on this. I think that they had a big part in this development of the pharmaceutical interventions that, of course, have been very good, and I think you deservedly give them lots of credit for our increased life expectancy.
I couldn't agree more, but no one knows that. I mean, outside of, which is the point I would make. And that would really relate to number two there. And perhaps number four, the message part.
Dennis, as expected, magnificent message and one that I hope we will think about long and hard. My comment is not so much for you as for any 20 or 30-somethings that are in the audience, particularly any of you who might be somewhat out of step with the mainstream or marching to a slightly different drummer or having ideas that your colleagues think are just a little bit, they're okay, but they're a little bit off. If you continue that pathway, 30 years from now or 20 years from now, you may be standing in front of us, as Dennis is, talking about a magnificent lifetime of achievement. So if there are any of you in the audience, keep it up.
Thank you.
Dennis, thank you for a very nice talk. Let me ask you, in business, one other piece that you really didn't discuss much is an investment in things that aren't currently valuable, but yes, that are envisioned to be valuable in the future. And that was not really part of your vision that you described today, but it would seem to me that if we invest our efforts in the things that are cheap and work now, 20 years from now, we won't have the biology on how to improve cognition or other things that might be more important then. And I think a School of Public Health's role is not so much to do what's important today, but to be developing the foundations for practitioners to be doing things 10 and 20 years out in the future.
Yeah, that was, I probably could have expanded this theme a lot more. I couldn't agree more with you. And maybe that's it. Let me try to get the right slide here. The challenge, I think, is to in the interest of, I had a lot more stuff, but in the interest of trying to talk in 35 to 40 minutes, I also cut a lot of stuff out. I'm sorry to keep going backwards, but I wanted to really pick on the slide that I think needs to be dramatically expanded, which I think would address your question.
Be worth that if they're looking at something exciting for the future.
Exactly. Wow, I'm going. I'm sorry. Well, it's the economics, genomics, and informatics. But then I had another slide earlier with, yes, the new disciplines and the traditional disciplines. I feel that this theme has to be looked at very carefully and very diligently, because I don't actually believe that all the right things are taught in the school. And that is exactly the point there. So I couldn't agree with you more. That theme must be developed a lot more. Anne.
Thank you very much. And I really appreciated that that your talk covered the world and that you compared developing and developed countries. And my question is about that. How important do you think it is for a school of public health of the 21st century to have a faculty and a curriculum and a research portfolio that spans the globe and that any student coming out of this beautiful new atrium would understand what malaria is and the prevention of it, would understand unsafe sex and what we do about that. And I'd like to know your views on that since you've been in this school for a long time.
Well, I think the way I tried to balance the talk really gives the answer there. I do think it is truly bimodal, so probably 50% or thereabouts in the developed world and probably an equal amount in the developing world. And the developing world has very much different problems. And I think I particularly showed the Bill Gates Foundation in part to make the point that you can have a huge impact from a totally different area. Money is important also, but money well used. But it's interesting, you know, the software king, the height of a modern man who makes it so good he's the world's richest man, is actually impacting the developing world in a major way. I think a greater impact in the developing world is very important also for political reasons, because otherwise, at least in my view, a number of problems in the world may be coming about because there's accelerating distance between societies rather than a narrowing of some of the distances, which 30 or 40 years ago, when I was a very young student, I thought we were on a path of narrowing things, and we seem to have gone on a path of really separating things. So I would be most supportive of a fairly balanced view between the problems of a developed society and the problems of developing societies. And hopefully that was reflected in my remarks.
You might comment that in valuing a dissertation, there really are two components, one being what's in the dissertation itself, and the experience the person doing the dissertation gains that launches them to do other research the rest of their life, as well as to mentor other people to do their research the rest of their life. So you have this future value that can be added into what would otherwise be the present value as well.
Yes, and that is absolutely true. And it's always possible to be a little glib in these examples, but sometimes the glibness makes another point that is not commonly looked at.
A lot to think about, and I know from my time in Washington that the issues of really transferring, or we often use the word disseminating, what we learn in academia into communities and into practices is just a major concern, and I was so glad that you addressed that. And I think even though we in academia might not think traditionally about the kind of value proposition that you talked about, I think it's time that we did, and so I want to really challenge us all to be stimulated by this, and even if we don't agree, to think about it, because it's I think we've just heard from somebody who has great insight into the world. again, I want to thank you, and we have a small token of appreciation, which is a calligraphy with the symbol of transformation done by Kaz Ta-Nehisi, who is a Zen master and painter and calligrapher. So, thank you, and I really want to encourage everybody to come upstairs and continue talking.
Thank you very much, Barbara.